Hello everyone, I'm Wang Pulin, a Huawei instructor. We have previously discussed troubleshooting APs that cannot come online. Firstly, it's important to note that our troubleshooting of APs not coming online still occurs at a wired stage. We still use a cable to connect the AP to the switch. In this situation, we use wired cables to log into devices and review various conditions, all within a wired environment. Troubleshooting is a familiar pattern, as long as one is familiar with the working principles of WLAN. The third part, starting from the failure to come online, will involve both wired and wireless issues. Both wired and wireless issues can prevent terminals from coming online. Let's briefly look at what troubleshooting processes we have when terminals cannot come online. The terminal has failed to come online. First, check if the failure reason can be identified using the command display online fail record to check if the fault has failed. If there is a reason, it's simple. We can take action based on the identified reason. If the reason is not visible, we need to check if the terminal can obtain an IP address, which is the first step. For beginners learning WLAN, they might often get stuck here. Everything seems fine with the AP, but there's an issue when the terminal tries to obtain the AP address. And that's when you need to pay attention. Check whether the business VLAN is allowed, or if there is a problem with the DHCP configuration. The third step is the issue of channel utilization. If the channel utilization is high, then you need to consider adjusting and optimizing the channel. Because if the fault is high channel utilization, then it's a wireless issue. Determine if the problem is channel utilization or co-channel interference. Then moving on, it could be the Wi-Fi driver side. Abnormal queues. This place has a caching mechanism. Normally, we rarely need to check this. Next, let's look at CAPWAP timeouts, which we also rarely consider unless you are troubleshooting messages. Otherwise, you can't see it. For the last two issues, you can't see them. You need to capture packets to pinpoint where our problem lies. Finally, the middle network issue, which we should have diagnosed earlier. If the terminal can obtain an IP address, then it can mostly come online. This rules out related middle network issues. So, it's quite simple, actually. The first problem with terminal online is the DHCP issue, whether my IP address can be obtained. The second is whether there are any issues like interference in the air or wireless environment. After the terminal comes online, there are a series of issues, such as whether the terminal can access the gateway, which you need to explore yourself, because accessing the gateway might involve crossing three layers. Routing might also need to be addressed. Now let's discuss some possible reasons for terminal online failure. Let's first look at the reasons displayed by the terminal. Use display station online fail record to check the reasons for terminal failure. Additionally, on the MAC address side, there will be a reason the STA is in the VAP's blacklist, which means the terminal is in our VAP blacklist. We just find the blacklist, display plus pipeline service, to find the MAC address configured blacklist. Just remove it. This checks the reason for user online failure. There are many reasons for user online failure. Let's take a look, such as the blacklist, including global blacklist, dynamic blacklist, and our VAP blacklist. Check specifically which blacklist it's in. Generally, we don't use the blacklist, but with what do we use it? With our IDS and IPS. IDS is an intrusion detection system. For example, if I detect your AP constantly sending useless messages, sending attack messages, then I'll directly pull your AP's MAC address into the blacklist. This is the intrusion detection and prevention system. It has an automatic addition to the blacklist feature. Another is the globally effective blacklist, which we can manually add. For instance, if you're an administrator, you know a certain IC or a MAC address is incorrect, is external or you want to block it, then you can add the two MAC addresses to the globally effective blacklist in the system. The third issue is the prohibition of traditional terminals from entering the function, which is quite rare, so we can overlook this issue for now. The fourth is that the terminal used a static AP. If the terminal uses a static address without specific requirements, you should still change it to dynamic. If you must use a static address, you need to confirm the static AP address. Check if there are any issues with the mask configuration, IP subnet, and ensure there are no address conflicts, as this can be more problematic. This is the scenario when a terminal uses a static address. Moving on, the next issue is authentication failure. Authentication failures could be due to incorrect username or password entries. Next, exceeding the maximum capacity of AP-managed terminals is very rare. The load on the AP generally does not exceed its limits. For example, even the simplest APs today might have the capacity for 256 users, but we might limit it to a maximum of 50. In such cases, this could lead to issues with terminal limits. Next, there's the issue of the RF load being too heavy on associated terminals, which is similar to RF tuning problems. In load balancing scenarios, we use load balancing in high-density settings like conference rooms, deploying several APs. These APs balance the load among themselves. And if a large number of users connect, we begin to distribute the total number of users among all APs. This is one method of load balancing. The reasons for upper limit failures have mostly been mentioned earlier. The first is to check whether the terminal has obtained an IP address. Check the IP address obtained by our terminal, and whether there are any issues with its VLAN and DHCP related configurations. Adding another reason, older terminals might have inherent issues, not related to the WLAN system, which could also cause them to fail to come online. I've seen a case where a user was a network administrator, but their company had purchased a large batch of wireless network cards for desktops. The quality of the wireless cards used by those desktops wasn't very good. I'm not sure which manufacturer they were from. When they connected, we tested with laptops. For example, the signal bandwidth was 65. They tested it, and it was 75. At 75, it wasn't very stable. It kept fluctuating. Sometimes it might be 80, sometimes less. What does this lead to? It results in occasional connection failures, for instance, if the power is too low. Because we set a threshold on the AP, based on this RSSI, we might not allow it to connect. There is a setting for this, possibly set at 75 if it's negative 80. Then it might not connect at all. So the terminal itself could also be a reason for user connection failures. We need to look specifically at what device it is. We need to specifically look at what device it is and exactly which standard the device conforms to. This is something we need to pay attention to. Especially, we must check what impact it has on the device. The second issue is special characters. Some terminals cannot recognize Chinese characters. This is something to be aware of. For instance, modern systems like Windows 10 can handle it. Chinese characters, you can now scan for Chinese SSIDs. If you set a normal ID, such as your phone's hotspot, it will display as someone's Huawei Mate 30 Pro. But if you are using an older version of the terminal, what problems might occur? It might not display your complete SSID. What it shows could be garbled. This is something to watch out for. Normally, it's recommended to use English letters or numbers for SSIDs. Of course, you can choose Chinese. If you think most devices support it, it's also fine. But usually, it's not recommended. The third thing is to check the AP's RF. If the channel utilization is too high, check it. What is the current channel utilization rate? This is a common reason for user connection failures. Now, let's look at some cases. First, the AP's VAP association user limit reached causing terminals to fail too. Associate, preventing them from coming online. Execute the display station online fail record command. It shows that the number of terminals on the AP has exceeded the number allowed by the VAP. In this case, we can adjust the reasonable number of connections. If the number of terminal connections has indeed exceeded, it is advisable to deploy more APs. Previously, there have been scenarios where customers directly reported, saying their recent network experience was very poor and asked us to identify the reasons. When you go to pinpoint the reasons, such as occasional association failures, you find that some APs might have 80 users connected, while others might have only 5 users. It's difficult for users to connect in the area with 80 users, often unable to go online. Where there are 5 users, any association is possible, and they can go online easily, but it's underutilized. If these two areas are close, you can implement a load balancing. If they are far apart, it's advisable to deploy another AP in that area to distribute the traffic. This method can solve the problem where terminals cannot associate. Now let's take a closer look at the number of associated terminals. Using display station, along with AP, specifically which AP, the number of devices associated, we can see very detailed information. That's our ID, right? RF is 0. WLAN ID is 2. RF2.4G. Then it uses 11N for transmission. As well as the reception and transmission rates, SSID also not high. Dash 70 is also relatively low. We can see very detailed information displayed on our monitor. It specifically shows how many different terminals there are. For example, there are 32, 20 on 2.4G, and 12 on 5G, making a total of 32 terminals. Generally, this is well below our threshold. You can afford to relax it a bit, like allowing up to 30 on 2FG and up to 30 on 5G, which is quite common. Another aspect is how to adjust the number of terminals associated with VAP. First, you can look in the SSID profile. The legal maximum association is 32, so how do you adjust it? Adjust it to 70. A single AP is recommended for 30. A dual band AP is recommended for 50. But this is not absolute. It still depends on your needs. If there are no special requirements, this setup should satisfy your usage. But if there are specific bandwidth requirements, like a media company running a video website, you might need to connect a larger number of APs to ensure usage of large bandwidth. These are common scenarios where issues might prevent terminals from coming online. This concludes the troubleshooting of STA, failing to come online. In our next lesson, we will continue learning about other WLAN troubleshooting cases. Thank you, everyone. Goodbye.